Hello and welcome to Bangalore International Centre's very own podcast, BIC Talks. Bangalore International Centre is a platform for informed conversations, exchange of ideas, and a space for arts and culture. BIC Talks brings the essence of all that the physical space stands for and more to your doorstep.
We are living in unprecedented times with a global pandemic that is affecting every aspect of our lives. How can sociology and anthropology and the extant research and knowledge inform us about the present moment? Scholars Veena Das and Maya Ratnam join us on BIC Talks today to delve into the crisis, the science, the democracy, and emerging forms of the state. Veena Das is a professor of anthropology at Johns Hopkins University and joins us from Baltimore. Welcome, Veena.
Thank you.
And anchoring the conversation today is Maya Ratnam, also an anthropologist who teaches at Ahmedabad University. Welcome, Maya, and over to you for the rest of the discussion.
Thank you, Pavan. Thank you, Raghu. And of course, thank you, Veena, for taking some time out to do this. It's really a delight and an honor to be given the chance to do this conversation with you. There are many thoughts since the onset of this peculiar time. There's many inchoate and unformed thoughts that I've been having, some of which we've had a chance to share over other research platforms. But this really gave me a chance to try and write down some of that, try and systematize some of those thoughts. And really, who better to have as a captive audience to try and respond to some of this? So thank you so much, Veena, for joining this conversation. Okay, so what I thought I'd do is I'll just sort of share with you some of what I've been thinking about, and you can just respond to the questions as I pose them. Does that sound okay, Veena?
Oh, that sounds terrific. And let me start by saying that it's a great pleasure to be here and to be talking to you. And thank you very much to Ravi and Raghu and Pavan for making this possible.
You know, the world is now several months into this crisis, and an uncanny kind of reality has taken hold, shaped by this pandemic, as it were. And it's already, this pandemic has come to form a sort of background or backdrop against which other global events have, you know, resumed their swirl, as it were. And my first thought really was on our understanding of a crisis and how we can comprehend a crisis sociologically and philosophically. And here I'm actually thinking of a few different things. One is that, of course, there was a foreshadowing or a prediction of precisely this sort of crisis. And I'm thinking here of prior testimonies that have been offered in US congressional sessions as early as 2005. Bill Gates has repeatedly spoken about, you know, the importance of developing a vaccine for an oncoming virus. In a recent volume that I was reading for my research, the authors write that the condition of slums and slum living that has so normalized, that has so come to define urban living across much of the global South, is really the precondition for a pandemic of this kind. And yet we find that public acknowledgement of these sorts of predictions or foreshadowing are always retrospective. So, you know, the beginnings of a pandemic really get constructed almost when we're in the smack dab in the middle of this pandemic. And likewise for their ending, how does a crisis of this sort end? Is it when the WHO declares that it's over? I was really thinking about how you would think about the temporality of this crisis and about the boundaries of this event.
You already laid out the kind of direction in which the answers might proceed. So one of my first question would be, why does it take a crisis to make us think about the dismal kinds of conditions of healthcare, not only in India, but in fact in many countries, and the absolutely deleterious effect of social inequalities on the way in which a pandemic or an epidemic will actually roll out. So you're right that the issue that there might be a pandemic some time has been before Congress. It has been before policymakers. There have been huge controversies around that question. Because part of the problem of only concentrating on crisis is that you don't quite know when the crisis will happen. You might say, yes, it can happen next year. It can happen 10 years from now. It can happen 15 years from now. So instead of thinking that we should have been prepared for a crisis, I think that if one shifted that to say, what about the crises that the poor tend to face every day, which in fact don't touch the lives of the rich as much? And I'm thinking of the dismal healthcare structure for the poor in the Indian context. The pandemic does not happen on a blank slate. So everybody is talking about a new normal, but one has to recognize that the old normal was not something which was like everything was functioning reasonably okay and then the pandemic came and disturbed these arrangements. It's that the pandemic found in a certain, or the virus found in a certain sense, the cracks in the society. And in some ways, it began to insert itself within these cracks, right? And I think one of the crises of dealing with this pandemic is not simply that people paid no attention to what was said in 2005, but that very little attention was paid to the signs that there was a pandemic around the corner. In some ways, it seems to me that instead of thinking only about the crisis, we need to think about the relationship between an event like a pandemic and the everyday life, both in terms of not simply saying we had always known a pandemic will happen, but saying why is it that when in fact in your neighboring countries this is beginning to happen, you know that you have, say, medical students studying in Wuhan who are likely to come back. How is it that so little preparation was made?
Thanks for that. You know, you've had throughout your long sort of engagement with these issues, you've had a very singular approach to defining what you've called critical events, to doing the, you know, the biography of events through how these events enter into the fabric of what you call the ordinary. Can you say a little bit for our listeners about how you conceptualize the ordinary? You know, I've studied under you and many of us have read so much of your work together. And the theme was very sort of pronounced in, of course, your work on violence. But even in your more recent work on health, we can see that picture of the ordinary helps, I find, to understand how you're approaching even something like health-seeking behavior or decision-making or the financial lives of the poor. So can you say a little bit about this notion of ordinary that has been so present in your work?
I should say that obviously something like the everyday has been the subject of obviously the whole Annales school in some ways brought the everyday into the center of attention in historical studies. In the case of sociology and anthropology, there was the question of people like Lefebvre or, you know, many, many people who have thought about the everyday. I think the one very big difference I think I came upon, and I take that further in Affliction, but also my new book on textures of the ordinary, which Black Swan is actually bringing out the Indian edition, I think this month itself. But one of the very interesting revelations that came to me as almost sort of, you know, moments of epiphany in fieldwork was the fact that the general picture of the everyday was that it was basically a question of routine and repetition. And so there's a lot of emphasis in anthropology about the banality of the everyday and the fact that in order for something to be noticeable, you have to think about moments of transcendence. You have, you know, why does a hammer come to your attention? It comes to your attention because it doesn't work. And what I tried to do, and it's been a really uphill task, was to say that it's not like the temporality is that everything is going according to repetition and routine, which are totally banal, and then there are these moments of escape from it, you know, when you hear a beautiful piece of music, or worse, when you see your faith in human beings shaken because somebody has been brutally killed or a child has been abducted and raped. Those are, you know, those are important moments of mourning. But the dark night of the soul is not the only way in which we can think about the notion of the everyday. So my main contribution, if I may say so, was to show how the everyday itself is a certain site in some ways in which the uncanny, the strangeness actually hits you, right? And not because there are certain moments that with that happens, but in the absolute ordinariness of things where a particular word or a particular sentence or a particular gesture can point in a certain sense to the fact that under these still waters, what you are looking at is very still waters, there are these turbulent things that are going on, right? And so that's why in my work on violence, I think what people might have found very difficult to reckon with was the idea that the answer to tremendous, horrible, horrendous events that people had was not to provide other an equally dramatic kind of, you know, scenes of recovery. But in a certain sense, the ability of the minute and the ordinary and the everyday to stand up to this horror. Very simple things like being able to resume or to able to pay attention to a crying child, even when you are in the middle of the fact that there is a tremendous, like in the case of the Sikh riots, where I worked for almost 2 years consistently, and not as long as lawyers worked, and I really admired them for that. But where I was, it was very noticeable to me the fact, the effort that it took to move back from the street to the house and to actually clean the house, and not seeing that cleaning the house as a betrayal of the fact that, oh, you were now returning to ordinary life, but assuming that this loss would stay with you even within your everyday quotidian actions, right? That notion of the ordinary is very difficult because also of this entire pressure in, I think I noticed that because I'm actually doing a class right now with the novelist and trying to learn how they think about description, for example.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I mean, it requires a lot of homework and all of that, which I'm enjoying. But I'm struck by the fact that one of the difficulties she has with my work, even in the process of just doing these exercises, is that they all think that the narrative is always about a disturbance that happens, how you deal with that disturbance, and how something like a conflict is ultimately resolved. And my attention has been to say that even something like an event, like, and I don't mean just large events, I mean even small events, such as illness in the house, right, will leave residues, right? That is to say, sometimes I'm very surprised, you know, we have this kind of, sometimes when we work, we have this kind of things like saying on a subjective scale, where would you put your health between 1 and 5? And it's very surprising. A lot of the poor will not actually say that their health is very bad, right? They'll say 4 or they'll say 5, right? And you look at that and you say, But
somehow that doesn't reconcile with the sort of family histories of illness and, that they've given us. Yeah.
That's right. Even with the fact that last month you said you were hospitalized, right? And this person said, yes, I was. But look how many people came to see me. And so I feel like I'm in very good shape. So in one way, attention to that and being able to write that in a way that the reader will in some ways see that a crisis is not just something which, oh, this is so big and it has happened, But it's also that there are things around us which we cannot not see, but we choose not to see them. Right? This has become so clear with regard to racism in the US, right? It was always a puzzle for me about slavery that, you know, it's not just a question that here there were norms and everybody shared in the norms of slavery. So why would you expect Jefferson or Washington to be able to live by 20th century norms? And I always ask myself, no, but you know, these slave women were going to them and saying, look, you are auctioning my child. This is also your child that you are auctioning out, right? And, you know, and their heartbreak was something constantly expressed to them, right? And so I think the real question is, why do we not see what is before our eyes? This is a crisis which happened. Now we've got a vaccine. Now it's over. You know, I think that will be the worst tragedy.
But also, even without this sort of attentiveness, we'll keep saying we've moved into something new, without ever really having any sort of textured understanding of what this new has meant for people. Many of the households that I've spoken to, the lockdown has made, they have had to withdraw children from school, which would have, you know, it could have been a very different situation otherwise. But now they've actually had to, like you said, you know, it's a generation that's going to be impacted, you know, very differently.
And there's so little discussion of that. Because everybody's going to think, oh, thank God, you know, that it didn't affect the children. Well, it took a toll on the poor. It took a toll on older people. There's no question about that. We don't even know that, for example, so many people have died of comorbidities, not necessarily of COVID. And obviously, there's no definite way in which one can say, oh, because, you know, unless they were tested, how do we know this was not COVID? I think it's the wrong question to ask. The question to ask is, this is a social biological event. It's not just a biological event. It's not just the microbe. The microbe is as much a social entity as it is a biological. But I can tell you that what really helped people survive was the actual moral economy of the poor. I mean, we always think of the poor as if they were only takers, and we haven't seen how much giving they do. So, you know, you talked about the financial life. I think the financial life of the poor are extremely complex, no less difficult than managing a portfolio, you know, of a CEO, because they're constantly having to manage getting credit from here and paying interest over there and being able to give money to another relative who's in a worse condition than you are, and so on and so forth. And there is such blindness to those facts that I have to say that in some ways, the combination of a paternalism towards the poor and the suspicion towards the poor is where it does just seems to me to have had very disastrous consequences.
You know, Veena, it's sort of well known, of course, among historians of pandemics and epidemics that the management of these crises itself leads to enormous consolidations and extensions of state power. And this has, of course, been something that has worried commentators, civil society people, academics, all concerned citizens, you know, across the board. Can you say something about what sort of anthropology of the state we can or we must do now, or what new political forms or formations that we should remain attentive to and wary of?
Thank you again for that question, because, you know, as you know, I've argued that the state never did disappear, right? This particular formation to say that, oh, now we have globalization and states have become less important, certainly there were changes, the sort in which the, you know, the question of how the state and the market were aligned were different. But as early, you know, if you just think about, there's some really interesting comparative materials on this. For example, Michael Puett's work on China, which tends to show that the Chinese main political leadership began to be drawn from engineers. And these engineers were all educated in neoliberal economics. So the Chicago School had a lot of impact on them, but they thought that they, one point they got wrong was that they didn't see that the state was central to the running of markets. Right? And it's really interesting. We see that in Foucault when he's looking at neoliberalism, he's saying you know, that there's a myth of free markets, really. What you did get was a certain, I mean, if you just think of the rise of people like the Ambanis, could they have done it without the particular way in which crony capitalism worked in combination with the state? Where have we had free markets? I think the one thing neoliberal economics did was to say that instead of moral arguments, you need to replace them with economic arguments, right? But, you know, this didn't happen for things like terror or for all the terror legislation. Nobody actually calculated and said, well, if we apply economic reasoning to it, then really paying all these people, 300 people arrested for what in the end will turn out to be only 10 people who we were able to get cases against, that it's not economic, right? Or in the US. I mean, the entire burgeoning of the prison populations, for example, you know, in one way it became aligned with the market because the management became private. And I see the same now that in one way, I don't know about the collapse of capitalism because, you know, this is a period, if you just see, go into things like market advice, you have really high rate of people into real estate thinking this is an opportunity rather than this is a disaster. So I think that is a very good question, and one would really have to first dismantle. I mean, what happens is we begin to use words as if they were magic words. So if you can say market, if you can say state, you can say power, you have the analytical apparatus. Whereas what you need to do is to really think hard about how these particular institutions begin to align and realign. And you're absolutely right that there is a kind of expansion of state power. But I have to say that in the case of India, and this may be just because countries or people that you really love beyond reason are places for which you really want that somewhere there will be glimmers of hope. And I mean, it does seem to me that things like the feminist movement, the whole way in which lawyers have been working to really try and create modes of representation to contest the state, I mean, these sit along with very depressing developments that have happened. And what can one do? One can basically just say, this is where I put my hope.
To look for how things combine and realign and fissure and realign in different ways, rather than just asking, okay, you know, is this the retreat of the state or the collapse of the market, you know? So yeah, I think those have perhaps become maybe lazy habits of thought that we've kind of fallen, grooves that we've fallen into. But any conversation with you just completely furrows new grooves and new lines of complication and, you know, gives us sort of new ways of asking questions of the world, you know, that we're in. You know, I think you said in a recent piece, I think it was in the American Ethnologist, that it's a sort of a land which is neither hope nor despair.
I mean, I think of Gandhi and I kind of think that in a way you would have just said, look, you have to do what you can best do. And there will be things that will be beyond me or beyond somebody else. And you would just have to say, all right, I mean, you know, when Wittgenstein says my spade is turned, this is what I do. That's where I would like to end this. But thank you for these fantastic questions. Thank you.
Veena, Maya, thank you so much for joining us on BIC Talks.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us. It was really great.
And dear listeners, don't tune out just yet. Jazz singer Radha Thomas from Bangalore and pianist Tomoko Ono Farnam from New York present a love song, Corona Kinda Crazy.
So crazy, Corona kinda crazy. I'm sitting all alone and I'm feeling so blue. I'm really going crazy, Corona kind of crazy. This isolation leaves me with nothing to do. If I had known how hard it would be to break through, I'd have fixed it so that I would be locked down with you. Do you think that you could sneak in the middle of the night when nobody is watching, keeping mostly out of sight? You can wrap yourself in the darkness, stay away from light. I know you're breaking laws just to make me feel alright. Even if you've got the sea, well, I wanna share your plight. 'Cause what's yours is mine, and mine is yours. Don't you think that it's right? You know it's you I'm trying to lure. Come on over, baby, you can use the back door. Won't it ever go away from all around the world, this nasty, ugly monster that's making people sick? I'm hoping that it will. Please don't say it won't. Will we ever stop this world pandemic? Now maybe it's just a dream, maybe a magic trick. Without you in my arms, I'm a wild lunatic. Without you in my arms, I'm a wild lunatic. Without you in my arms, I'm away.
Thank you for listening in till the end. Please share this episode with a friend on social media, WhatsApp, or anywhere else. It would mean the world to us. And in case you're listening via iTunes or Apple Podcasts, please leave us a rating and a review. Subscribe to BIC Talks on email or your favorite podcast app, and don't miss out on future episodes. This episode of BIC Talks has Gaurav Krishna as our sound engineer, with support from S. Sarvanaraj and Lekha Naidu. And the accompanying episode artwork was made by Chandni Venkataraman.
Thank you for listening to this episode of BIC Talks. This podcast can be accessed on our website, bangaloreinternationalcenter.org, as well as on any of your favorite podcast platforms. Tune in for new episodes every week, and do subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow our Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram pages to stay informed on our latest updates.